had a question recently from a subscriber going by the name of GoGoGate7056, and they'd been watching the video I did on reflection and had spotted a technique I'd used without explanation, although it's quite a common way of doing things in C#. If you're not familiar with it, it's not really clear what's going on. So what we saw here was this bit here where I've got this get properties and then I pass in binding flags public or binding flags instance. So what I'm asking for is to get any properties which are public and instance, that's to say non-static. But both of those are enums, and it's a bit odd the way we're combining them with this OR operator, this pipe operator. So let's have a look at our own example and see what we can do with all that. So here, like in so many examples, I've got a book class that just has a title and an author and then a toString to combine those together. And then in my program, I'm just creating a book and printing it out. So when we run that, pretty simple, it just prints out that book. But when you have a book, there can be various different formats in which that book has been published. So we can have things like a hardback or a paperback or other variations as well. And those are the sort of things we might want to put into an enum. So in here, I'm going to have a public enum, which I'll call formats. And then let's go for, say, possibly hardback or paperback or ebook or audiobook, let's say. So could be some others, but that's just four that we can get on with. And then into my book class, we'll add a property of type formats called format. And then let's also add that onto the toString. And then back in the program, let's give this a format of formats dot, and let's go for hardback. And so now if we run that one up, we should see that it prints out hardback. And you can see one of the nice things about enums, that the toString on an enum that's being called implicitly there gives you back the actual name you've given for the enum. But what we also know is underneath that, those enums are simply numbers. And by default, they number off 0, as we can see, 1, 2, and 3. But the thing that we've got there, this class book, is representing just a single book. So it's got the title of the author and a particular physical book will be either a hardback or a paperback or whatever. But what we might be trying to represent here is not the individual physical book, but the concept of the book in the bookshop's catalogue or something like that. And with our format, we may not be trying to say what specific format this specific book is in, but what formats this particular title is available in. So we could change that to available formats and just do a quick rename so that that will be updated everywhere. And then we could say that this particular book is available as a paperback and an ebook, but not as a hardback and an audiobook, or whatever combination we want. But to do that, we have to employ this trick with enums. And it's a trick that dates back a long, long way. I've certainly done this in C++. Even in a language like C that doesn't have enums, you can still do this idea with constants. And it all relies on the fact that we can give these things specific numbers. So if I say hardback equals 1, and then paperback equals 2, but then things get a bit different, because rather than what might seem obvious, that ebook equals 3, we say ebook equals 4, and audiobook equals 8. So you can see what we're doing is doubling the number each time. 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, if we wanted to go on with those. And the reason we do that is if you think about how these numbers are going to look in binary, then each one of those four enums represents a different digit in binary. So in binary, 1 is just 1, 2 is 10, 4 is 100, and 8 is 1000. So each one is this individual binary digit. And that means that we can combine them to have any combination that we want. So if we put together a hardback and a paperback, that would be digit 2 and digit 1. So 1, 1 would represent them. And the hardback and the paperback digit will never interfere with each other. If we wanted something that was both audiobook and hardback, that would be 1001. And again, the two digits don't interfere with each other. And so having done that, that now means we can combine them. And so the way we combine them is simply with the OR operator. So If I want this to be both a hardback and, let's say, an audiobook, I can just use or and then formats.audiobook. And that or, that pipe, is the binary or. It's not the logical or, which is a double pipe. It's the binary or. And so that's going to take those numbers and it's going to put them together, and those two binary digits will be in there separate but together in the one variable. It's a little bit odd when we're reading this, because what we're trying to say here in plain English is that the available formats are hardback and audiobook. So we're combining them conceptually as an and, but because of the way it's working with these bits, we've got to put the pipe in there. Once we've done that, we can do some really quite neat things, because now we can discover which particular formats are supported. So if I were to do something like this, I could say if, and then I can say book dot available formats. And here is where I use the and, because if I say book dot available formats and formats dot audiobook, then whatever the bits that are set in there, in this case hardback and audiobook, if one of them is audiobook, then the and will give us a result. So that will mean we get a number other than zero. If it's not matched, it'll give us zero. So all we need to do is say, if that does not equal zero, that means that particular bit is set, and therefore we can say something like console write and it's available as an audiobook. And so if we run that, we'll see that that's what we're getting. Whereas if we didn't have audiobook, if we had ebook, then we don't get anything at all printed out because it's not available as an audiobook. And so that's the way that, as I say, since time immemorial, we've done this sort of thing. We use the or to combine them, and then we use the and to test to see if a particular one's there. And if that gives us a non-zero result, then we know that that is there. Now, although using the or is pretty much the standard way to do it, using this and for testing can be a little bit odd when you look at the code. So there is actually an alternative that was introduced quite a while ago in .NET version 4 that we have on an enum this method called HasFlag. So we can actually just say, if available formats HasFlag audiobook, and let's put the audiobook back in there, and that really just internally does exactly the same with the single ampersand, but it's just a little bit more readable, a bit more expressive of what we're trying to do. So if we run that one up, that will behave in exactly the same way. So very nice technique that we've got there. Let's, though, put back in that console write line of book. Because remember what's happening there is we are just using the string interpolation, putting in that available formats, and it's going to call the toString on that. Now, if we had just a hardback and we run that, then it prints out, as we saw before, hardback. But if we have more than one thing, bear in mind that this hardback is 1, audiobook is 8, so the actual numerical value of available formats is going to be 9, the combination of those two. And the problem is we don't have anything with a 9 in that formats. And so when we run that one, it gets confused as to what to do, and all it can do is give us the number 9, which is correct, but it's not particularly expressive. It's not as nice as seeing the actual name of the enum. So there's one extra thing we can do here, in that on an enum, if you've used this doubling approach, this single binary digit approach, then we can give the enum an attribute of flags. And that is simply saying that this is what we're trying to do. You've still got to get the numbers right for yourself. It doesn't do that automatically, but you put that in there. And that gives us just this one slight advantage that now when we run that, it knows that if it's got a number, it can break it down and look at the 2 or 3 or however many enums have made that. So there we've got hardback, comma, audiobook. If I put in another one as well, say paperback, then it will just give us, again, a comma-separated list there. So that's quite a nice thing to have. Still a couple of problems to worry about, though. What if we didn't put anything in there at all? So if I just comment that out, then available formats is going to default, and it's going to default to 0. And again, we've got the problem that there is no 0 value in there. And so when we run that, It's just giving us the number 0. So something you should always do if you're doing this approach is put in a 0. And very often you'll call it none, but we could call it no format or whatever we thought was appropriate. But now it's got a none value, and that means we can explicitly set it to none if we want to. So we could say available formats equals formats.none, or we could default it, but it means that when it is none, then it'll actually have the none printed out there. So that's a neat thing to do. The final thing that we can do here is just to bear in mind that if we're doing this sort of thing, we can quite quickly run out of space, because each one of these is going to be a binary digit. If you've got an enum, then that by default is going to be the same size as an int, that's to say 32 bits. So if you've got more than 32 things that you want in here, well, you might consider it's getting a bit complex anyway, but it could happen. But the nice thing is, remember, with an enum, you can specify the size of it as well as just defaulting it to int. So if I would go formats colon long there, now we have an enum format, but it's now going to be 64 bits, and so we could have a much larger range of possible values. We don't need it here, but it's just something you can do. You can put in different types. We could use smaller ones as well, but the default is going to be int, and that's normally okay. And so that's all there was to it. So a couple of things we do. We number them off by doubling the number each time, 1, 2, 4, 8, 16. Make sure you give it a 0 with the appropriate name, whatever you want to call it, and give it that attribute, and then we can OR them together. We've got the toString working fine, and we've got this has flag that allows us to see if a particular one is in there. And that's all that was happening back in the other program. So binding flags, public and instance, if we just take a look at that, there we can see here we've got that enum with the doubling each time, starting to get quite a big number, but still not got outside the range of an int. And then also we can see on there is our flags attribute. So a pretty simple idea, but very, very powerful, can mean you can write your code expressively using enums, which are clear for everyone to see, and get the toString back and working okay. So, hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do subscribe, do click like, and I'll see you next time.